Professor Ranjit Singh Boman, who is the Nehru Sail Chair Professor at the CRRID in Chandigarh. And this will be followed by a second presentation. So each presenter will have 20 minutes, or a little more than 20 minutes, 22 minutes. So I request Professor Boman now to straight away start with this presentation.
Good morning, everybody. The team to care, friends on the dais, and friends in the hall, participants. In fact, at the very outset, I would like to just my gratitude to the Padri, Mr. Naipal Gupta, and all his colleagues. Friends, growth, poverty, and inequality has been debated ever since 1950s, and at one stage, Kuznet showed us that inequality will be a inverted U-shaped curve. However, the evidence tells us that did not happen. Poverty, of course, has been taken care of growth, but not inequality. Now, the paper which is being presented over here is part of my UGC research award on this title. One subtitle was Human Development as well, but I have not taken in this paper. Not devoting too much time to the introduction, I would like to share that 8 countries are there in South Asia, and they are India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Nepal, Bhutan, Maldives, Afghanistan, and they together have 3.82% surface area and 3.31% per capita of gross global income. But South Asia inhabits 23.41% population. The region is the most populous region of the world, next only East Asia and Pacific. Still about 40% of its population. As compared to 47% rural population at the global level, this region has 69%. At the global level, this region have 14% share in the global GDP. Now, here in this context, India, Pakistan, and Bangladesh typically represent South Asia. Together, they account for 95% population, 96% GDP, and 82% of surface area of South Asia. Their share in world population is 22.3%. So typically, these 3 countries constitute or represent the picture of South Asia. Now, we also know that these 3 countries were one country till 1947. But Bangladesh became a sovereign country in 1971. So I have taken these 3 countries, and the period covered will be from 1980s, because Bangladesh came into being in 71. So 70s decade I have omitted for that purpose. Now, coming to growth, poverty, and inequality, theory and empirical evidence, there are several questions. One comes confronts day in and day out in theory and evidence also. Some of those questions are, do growth benefit trickle down automatically? Does growth results in poverty reduction? Does growth reduces inequality? The answer to these questions lies in distribution of income and wealth and, of course, assets and participation of the people in the growth and development process. Both the theory and evidence have for and against arguments and views and are broadly classified as under. Higher GDP growth rate decreases poverty and inequality. Higher growth rate lowers poverty but not inequality. Growth is poverty and inequality neutral. It is often argued that the market-driven growth and development paradigm would take care of growth, poverty, and inequality. However, economic theory and empirical evidence have far and against views on both the arguments. Here is the growth story, annual average growth rate in selected countries. So you see, from 1960s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and first decade of the 21st century, India has a consistent upward trend as far as growth rate is concerned. And the first turning point in India's growth story is happened during 1980s. Some say 50s was the first turning point. But this picture is very much clear. Whereas Pakistan's growth rate could not depict a clear trend, 6.7% in 60s, then comes down 6.3% in 80s, and then after 80s it doesn't pick up. Bangladesh growth story is almost similar to Pakistan, but when we come to the last decade of the 20th century and first decade of the 21st century, the growth rate picks up. Per capita GDP in these countries is also important. You see, per capita GDP both in dollar terms and PPP terms, India registered an increase of 400% in terms of nominal and 311% in terms of real. Pakistan's 200% and 51%. The respective figures for Bangladesh, 282% and 92%. So you see, India and Pakistan, India has a clear edge over Pakistan as well as Bangladesh. One thing I would like to share, that as per World Bank classification, both India and Pakistan are in the lower middle income category, whereas Bangladesh is still in the lower income category. Sectoral composition is equally important because origin of growth is there, and it also affects poverty and inequality. And most of the theory and evidence is that if the agricultural growth or primary sector's growth is higher, then it helps eradication of poverty and to some extent maybe inequality. Now the share of agriculture, you may ask that why I have not taken figures beyond 2009, because comparable figures at the international level for all the countries, for India we know it is 13%, the latest figure, but for other countries I couldn't find, but I would like to improve upon this later on. And I'll find the figures. Agriculture in India here declined from 31% to 18% during the period under study. Pakistan 26 to 22% and Bangladesh 29%. So in the last year, which is depicted here, Indian, Pakistan and Bangladesh, the share is almost same, but for Pakistan. So industry share is depicting a very, very interesting picture, and during this, there are 3 decades, there is hardly any change in the share of industries in India's GDP. It was almost stagnant, and it speaks volumes and gives answers to so many problems which India faces these days. Pakistan's share, the same story. Bangladesh, of course, increased from 21 to 29. services sector, interestingly, Pakistan and Bangladesh were service sector economy way back in 1990, whereas India's service sector was contributing 41%. Now it is 55%, and almost the same share of all the other two countries. Along with the share of sectoral share of income, labor force in agriculture and non-agriculture sector is very, very important, and the long-term dynamics of growth in theory tells us that as growth takes place, labor share and as well as GDP share of agriculture increases. But what have happened in all the three countries, particularly in India, the occupational diversification did not take place as per the long-term dynamics of growth, whereas GDP shares did behave according to the long-term dynamics of growth. If we take Bangladesh, from 50 to 70, for four decades, there was no change, but share declined, the GDP share. Now from 73 to 2010, it is declining from 79% in 73 to 45% in 2010. In the case of India, it declined from 71% in 73 to 55%, and now it is roughly 50%, the latest NSSO or census data tells us it's 50%. But still, you see, 50% of the workforce is sharing only 13% of the GDP of the country. And here you can appreciate the increasing gap between agriculture and non-agricultural workers, population dependent on agriculture and dependent on non-agriculture. You can well appreciate yourself. So in the case of Pakistan, the share of workforce is lower than the other two countries, but still it is quite substantial. So along with the sectoral share of labor, it's equally important to have a look at status of employment and vulnerability of those employed. So this is very clear that employment to population ratio in India is at number two. Bangladesh is having 73.5%, whereas Pakistan is having 56.3%. So then, vulnerable employment. You see, this is the crux of the problem. One seems employed, or NERC says there is disguised unemployment, but nothing to see, but we can see this vulnerability of employed, or this includes the working poor also. Now, vulnerable employment in India is 81%, in Bangladesh it is 85%. I couldn't get the figure for Pakistan. Youth unemployment ratio is quite high in India and Pakistan. Bangladesh figure is not available. Unemployment rate is also very high in India. Share of working poor at PPP $2 a day is 74% in India, 57% Pakistan, and 80% in Bangladesh. So this actually negates so many things what growth has achieved over the period. If with this growth rate we have experienced over the time, then we could not make any dent on the share of working poor and the vulnerable employment. I think this needs to be probed by policymakers as well as the government and academia too. This is the average annual agriculture growth rate. This is also important. And India's, again, during 60s and 70s remained stagnant as far as growth rate is concerned. However, it had a higher growth rate in 80s and 90s, and 2.9% growth rate in the first decade of the 21st century. But it recalls me the planning commission's claim that in 12th five-year plan, in 11th five-year plan, we will have 4% growth rate. Nowhere we are there. And probably that is why Monte Carlo earlier said, agriculture sector cannot give me 10% GDP growth rate. And even without that, we are not having 10% GDP growth rate. Anyway, Pakistan's agriculture growth rate has been higher than India and Bangladesh as well. But the growth rate in all the countries in agriculture is not too small that. Average annual industrial growth rate depicts a reasonably good picture, but in the case of India, it's almost, the trend is slightly upward, but in the case of Pakistan, even the trend is that not upward if we fit the trend line. And Bangladesh is having a better growth rate in industry. Annual average annual growth rate in the service sector. Now, service sector, we are almost crossing 50% GDP share in service sector, but and the growth rate is this. India achieved from 4.6% in the 70s to 9.5% in the last decade of in the first decade of 21st century, and trend is upward. Pakistan, however, service sector share in GDP is quite high, but trend is downward as far as growth rate is concerned. Bangladesh growth rate in this is also showing an upward trend. Coming to poverty, what this growth rate and sectoral growth rate have done? Coming to poverty, poverty figures are not comparably available. In India, we started having figures from 73 onward. In Pakistan, from 84, 85, and in Bangladesh, also 83, 84. But as far as rural poverty and urban poverty is concerned, in India, it declined from 45.6% in 83 to 28.3% in 2005. Urban poverty declined from 41% in 83 to 56% in 83, not going into the poverty line, whether it's good or bad, or there was much of criticism of that. But in the case of Pakistan, you see, rural poverty also declined, urban poverty also declined, but somewhere that decline is slow. But as far as international poverty line is concerned, all the countries have registered a decline, but dollars to a day is still a problem as far as inequality, this poverty is concerned. In the case of Bangladesh, this is very interesting. Growth rate has been there. Growth rate has been there. But poverty, even poverty, has not declined in spite of the higher growth rate. 55% in 95 and 41% in 2005. Bangladesh urban poverty declined, but rural poverty had little impact on growth rate. Another dimension of poverty is multidimensional poverty in these countries. 51% of India's population, this below poverty, is facing multidimensional poverty. 52% in the case of Pakistan and 48% in the case of Bangladesh. So contributory factors, health, education, they are also shown in the slide. But population very near to multidimensional poverty is also quite high. Now, coming to inequality, distribution of income or consumption. If you look at the lowest 10% population share and upper 10% population share, you can well imagine lower is almost stagnant or slightly declined in India, but upper tier has increased. So is the case with the 20% lowest and 20% highest. Inequality measures, if you take 7.7, 9.6, 8.6 times the ratio in the case of 10% and slightly lower in the case of 20%. Gini index in India has increased from 34% in 92 to 38% in 97 and but declined to 37% in the. However, Gini index in Pakistan remained almost same, and in Bangladesh it increased. So inequality has increased over the period of time, both in terms of share of lowest and of highest percentile and the Gini ratio. So what do we find from this? India, Pakistan and Bangladesh have experienced varying levels of GDP growth rate since 1980s. The moderate growth rate in India during 1970s led to a moderate decline in poverty incidence. The growth rate during 1980s and 1990s was fairly high in India. The sharp decline in rural poverty during 1980s and 1990s was also owing to a reasonably high growth, agricultural growth rate during this period. In the case of Pakistan, the high growth rate during 1980s led to significant decline in urban poverty, but rural poverty largely remained growth neutral. The growth in Bangladesh did not result into rural poverty reduction during 1980s and 1990s. It however reduced urban poverty reduction, but the downward trend in urban poverty too could not be a continuous phenomenon. Poverty incidence, both rural and urban in Bangladesh, had increased during 1990s. The growth in Bangladesh has thus remained neutral to rural poverty in particular and to urban poverty in general. Evidently, the theoretical causal relationship between growth and poverty was not visible in Bangladesh, at least during the decade of 1990s. As regards the causal relationship between growth and income inequality, the empirical evidence did not support the inverted U hypothesis. The share of lowest 20% population across the three countries has almost remained the same during the period under study. The share of top 20% population has, however, increased. The Gini index has either remained unchanged or has increased. The long-term trend also supports this fact. The high growth rate thus could not reduce income inequality. Many individual studies on poverty have put the incidence of poverty and extent of inequality at a much higher level than the government studies. What is happening to the people farther below poverty line is a moot question. The governments are more interested in showing the average poverty reduction, but not about those who are much farther from the BPL and are marginalized. In fact, growth alone would never be able to take care of such people unless these people are involved in the growth process and some effective policy measures are taken to correct the income poverty. And the last, it is amply clear from the foregoing discussion that growth has mainly resulted in a reduction of poverty, that is absolute poverty, but it did not touch inequality, rather in certain two of the countries it increased. The impact on poverty and inequality on growth is, however, invisible and complex. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor. That was very well managed. Now I request our next speaker, Professor Panchanan Das from the University of Calcutta, to present his paper on Structural Change, Poverty and the Informal Economy, India's Development Experience.
Thank you very much. Topic of my presentation relates to structural change, poverty and informal economy, Indian development experience. Now, as is well known, India passed through the high growth phase since the mid-1980s, especially during the post-reform period. But the benefits of growth were not found to trickle down adequately to the low-income groups even during the post-reform period. Structural change occurs, but in favor of the services sector. And the peasants, artisans, and petty producers in the real sector drew little benefit from this kind of structural changes and overall growth process in the economy. Thus, in explaining poverty, structural and institutional factors have to be considered along with GDP per capita. In this study, we have taken some institutional factors like land distribution, incidence of tenancy cultivation, particularly in explaining the rural poverty. Now, if we go through the history of development in our country, we can look at the poverty is embedded in the structure of the economy. Poverty in India mostly has been chronic, and structural rigidities of the economy are primarily responsible for perpetuation of poverty since independence. Excessive emphasis on heavy industries and capital goods production, followed by the Mahalanobis model of our training, earlier training models, mostly based on the Leontief dynamic structure, the neglect of agriculture, and the complete absence of any specific poverty alleviation program till the launching of the seventh plan period, raised inequality across persons, regions, and slowed down the process of poverty alleviation. Another important evidence of structural rigidities can be found in the form of employment pattern. Employment shares of agriculture declined, but at a very much slower rate as compared to the income share in most of the states in our country. Now, perpetuation of poverty and inequality are caused mainly by the existence of the large informal economy. There is ample evidence to show that poverty exists primarily in the informal sector. Informal economy accounts for roughly 50% of the GDP and about 90% of employment. There is hardly any major sector of the activities in our country which may be called entirely formal. Each sector of major activities has been increasingly depending on informal or unorganized segment of the economy, especially during the post-reform period. This overwhelming importance of informal economy actually reduces the poverty elasticity of growth. Growth of informal sector thus may reduce absolute poverty in India. Against these stylized facts, the major objectives of this study is to look into the incidence of poverty, both in terms of income and non-income parameters. In terms of income parameters, we have used the official estimates of poverty, headcount ratio. In terms of non-income parameters, we have used here per capita calorie intake per day as a proxy for poverty. In explaining poverty, we have considered structural and institutional factors along with GDP per capita. In econometric methodology, we have used here fixed effect error component model in a panel data framework. Our major conclusion of this study is that the growth trajectory fails to bring the major sectors away from informal activities where poverty is concentrated. The increasing employment of part-time workers in the unincorporated non-agricultural enterprises and the employment of contract labor in the organized manufacturing sector have facilitated growth during the post-reform period, but raised inequality in wage income and other form of benefits. The study is organized in five sections. After a brief introductory remarks, in section 2, we make a rapid survey of the Indian economy in the context of development strategy and structural changes. Section 3 addresses the pattern of consumer expenditure, nutrition, and poverty. Section 4 brings out the importance of both income and non-income parameters of poverty. Lastly, in section 5, we present some summary findings and conclusions. Now, let me provide some overview on structural changes. The Feldman-Mahalanobis model of our planning was not discarded till the 8th plan, which emphasized most on the heavy industries, capital goods industries. There are many works in showing structural break in our country in terms of sectoral components of GDP. Wallach in 2003 and myself in 2007 have done some work, and in both of the studies, structural break occurred in the early 80s or late 1970s in terms of net domestic product, manufacturing and services. While in agriculture, break came in 1965. Balakrishnan et al. In 2007 shows 1976 as a possible major breakpoint in terms of GDP. Thus, the break appeared much before the new economic policy was adopted by the Union government in 1991. And in this paper in 2007, I have brought out a considerable disparity in regional growth pattern as well. The share of services sector in net domestic product superseded all the other sectors, particularly since 1980-81. Agriculture recorded lower output growth rate along with the declining share in net domestic product. Growth in registered manufacturing is also far from satisfactory. And we can summarize the situation in terms of the sectoral composition of among three broad sectors, agriculture, industry, and services, that are calculated from the National Account Statistics, CSO. So agriculture share in GDP declined sharply from over 51% to nearly 14% in 2012-13. In industry, the share increased but very slowly from 11% to 18.9%. But in services, it declined rapidly from 34.6% in 1950-51 to 67.4% in 2012-13. Thus, structural change appeared particularly in favor of the services. Now, income poverty and the state. At the national level, well over one-fourth of the Indian population are in abject poverty. There are several pockets of poverty spread over a number of states like Madhya Pradesh, Bihar, Odisha, and Assam. It indicates the failure of the successive plans and economic reforms to alleviate poverty in a desired manner. It was not before the 7th plan poverty came to be recognized as a subject of state intervention. It was believed earlier that growth in capital goods production would automatically accelerate growth in other sectors, and there was no need for any special program for poverty alleviation by following the well-known trickle-down hypothesis. Now, these are the official estimates of poverty by states in different NSS rounds. We cannot compare all the rounds in strict sense because of methodological reasons. Since the 61st round, 2004-05, the estimates are based on the Tendulkar methodology. And in the 68th round estimates, 2011-12, as I have already mentioned, Assam, Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, and Odisha, incidence of poverty is more than 30%. Now, we have observed indifferent association between income poverty and calorie intake. Per capita calorie intake in this country still lies below internationally accepted standard. In many states, there has been a steady decline in calorie intake per capita, along with the fall in income poverty. This is positive somehow. Decline in calorie intake may be due to the growing prosperity of the people, according to Mahendradev in 2006 paper. Recently, we have also taken an initiative to look into the issue jointly with Professor Subodh Marjit. Professor Marjit has developed a simple model to explain why calorie intake is low, although income poverty declines in our country, in terms of the status good consumption. In terms of this paper, status good means the consumption for, that is the spending for showing televisions, spending for more education, etc. So that may be the probable reasons for declining shares of calorie intakes. But on the basis of this theoretical paper, we will try to explore whether it is empirically true in our country or not. But it is extremely unusual to think that the people who are one-fourth are not even literate have become calorie conscious. The decline in poverty was rapid enough in some states to make trickle-down growth hypothesis credible. But if we look at the calorie intake figures, we find strong ground for rejecting this kind of hypothesis. So these are the figures for calorie intakes by states on the basis of the same rounds of NSSO. Now, in the rural economy, we have taken land distribution pattern to explain the poverty, particularly in rural areas. Now, petty producers have little access to institutional credit. With the rise in cost of cultivation, they are forced to surrender their land rights. And so will the rank of agricultural laborers, having little bargaining power for their wages. And it is also true for West Bengal, where it is conventionally assumed that land reforms have been successful in this state, more meaningful manner. Workers have got the legal rights. They are entitled to got the institutional credits. But if we look at the NSSO data on farmers assessment survey for several rounds, we can easily show that the percentage share of sharecroppers declined gradually. And the nature of share tenancy changes in favor of the fixed money rates. So this may be one important area to look at why this kind of happening even in West Bengal. Now, concentration of land distribution creates a problem relating to poverty more complex. If we look at the inequality in land distribution, West Bengal and Kerala, where land reforms are more meaningful compared to the other states, lowest concentration of land. But in Punjab, Haryana, and recently agriculture growing states like Rajasthan and Gujarat have the higher Gini concentration of land distribution. So these are the figures obtained from the several rounds on farmers assessment survey based on the schedule 33. We have not reported here the latest 70th round results. We have reported here the earlier 59th round on 2002-03. But if we add the latest round, the results do not change markedly. Now, in our major work in this paper to explain the nature of poverty, in explaining poverty, we have considered growth rate of per capita state domestic product, both for rural and urban areas. As you know, we don't have any separate estimates for state domestic product for rural areas and urban areas separately. So in explaining rural poverty and urban poverty, we have taken the growth rates of the state state domestic product as available from the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. Gini coefficient in land distribution for the rural areas, tenancy rights, consumer price index for agricultural workers in the rural economy, growth of gross state domestic product from manufacturing in explaining urban poverty, growth of state domestic product from services in explaining urban poverty, along with the degree of urbanization as the possible major factors explaining poverty. The economic model, I am not going into detail, the technicalities, the fixed effect error component panel data model has been used. Estimation methodology is generalized least squared to avoid the problems of heteroscedasticity and autocorrelation. Fixed effect is chosen on the basis of the popular Hausmann test. The relationship is specified separately for the rural and urban areas like this. The left-hand side variable, YIT, is the income poverty in terms of headcount ratio, both in rural and urban area, as well as the per capita calorie intake in the case of non-income poverty. C is the intercept term. XG is the growth rate of GDP. GL, Gini coefficient in land distribution. T, the tenancy rights, CPI, consumer price index for agricultural workers. In the second equation, XG is the similar. MG, manufacturing growth. SG, services sector growth. UR, urbanization. Our panel consists of 15 major states as the cross-section units over the 7 quinquennial rounds of NSSO. Now, in Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, and Uttar Pradesh, we have combined, these states have been separated recently. So, Jharkhand and Bihar taken together to make it compared to the earlier rounds. Similarly, Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh taken together, Uttar Pradesh and Uttaranchal taken together to make comparable.
Please, can you compute
results? This is the results. Yeah, this is the results. So, in this, this is for the rural areas. So, per capita NSDP growth has no significant impact on rural poverty. However, the Gini coefficient of land distribution has a significant impact. Triple star indicates coefficients are significant at less than 1% level, double star significant at 5% level, single star significant at 1% level. So these are the results for per capita calorie consumption. So in that case, however, the growth rate has a significant impact in declining per capita calorie consumption, Gini coefficient, negative impact, incidence of tenancy also has negative impact in per capita calorie consumption. So these are for urban areas. In that case also, growth rate has no significant impact. However, manufacturing growth as well as the services sector growth has a significant impact in reducing urban poverty at the state level. Now, we have estimated some indicators of informalization on the basis of the 55th round NSSO as well as 67th round NSSO. Okay, just the last one. So in terms of employment growth, growth of value-added per worker, growth of capital intensity, share of part-time workers in total workers. So if we combine these tables to the income poverty, as we have already mentioned, so there may be strong correlations between the higher incidence of informalization to the higher incidence of poverty across the major states in our country. So the summary and conclusion, structural rigidities are primarily responsible for perpetuation of poverty since independence. Excessive emphasis on heavy industries and capital goods production, the neglect of agriculture, complete absence of any specific poverty alleviation program. Benefits of growth were not bound to trickle down to the low income groups. Per capita calorie intake has been used along with the controversial headcount ratio. Economic growth has insignificant effects on poverty, both in rural and urban areas. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will have a couple of discussions now, one of each paper. So you're discussing one of each paper. Okay, so. Manish Kumar, who is a postdoctoral ICSSR fellow at Adri, will discuss the paper, the first paper. Please, we have about 6 minutes left.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairperson. Thank you, Mr. Chairperson, Professor Thuman and Das for your presentation. Well, right at the outset, I must tell you that I've been asked to discuss a paper which has been written by a scholar who has more than 100 research papers, more than 12 written books, and equally great number of research projects with credits. So I have a tough task at hand. But since I'm sitting next to a highly conscious of high stature, so that gives me the courage and also then somehow gives me the courage to speak my mind. Well, before we discuss the paper, let me give you a brief background. Why this issue of poverty, growth, inequality has acquired such a important significance right now. Well, questions of growth, of poverty and inequality have always been important. Let me tell you right at the beginning. Even they were very at the very heart of the economics of Adam Smith, David Ricardo, John Stuart Mill, and Karl Marx. If you recall, Adam Smith wrote about division of labor and growth. David Ricardo, among other things, wrote about the distribution issues. And Karl Marx applied his intellectual energies to study the historical forces shaping societies and economies. But in the modern avatar, development economics took birth in the years following the Great Depression and the Second World War. Somehow we were made to believe that the development economists had solved the holy grail of the development problems. So we knew what needed to be done to transform an economy, a backward economy, into a modern one. You know, economists built grand theories like Rostow's model, Rosenstein-Rodin's big push, Lewis's unlimited supply of labor. Somehow or the other, each of these grand theories and model emphasized that we needed to focus on capital accumulation, needed to invest in human capital, needed to improve our savings rate and investment, and this is how you can propel to a higher growth trajectory. But over the last 5 or 6 decades, as we have seen, especially prior to the reforms when they were launched in 1991, the results were not up to the mark. We indeed made progress. There was industrialization, growth rates picked up 3.5%, per capita incomes grew. There were a lot of institution buildings which provided the basis for further growth, but still a lot needed to be done. But by the 80s, we realized that there was something wrong, and that led to the crisis. Fiscal profligacy and associated factors that cumulatively acted to create a crisis which ultimately led to the acceptance of market reforms in 91. And it wasn't just India which had embraced reforms in that point of time, in early 90s. There were many erstwhile communist nations which embraced reforms. And it was at this point of time the distinguished political scientist Francis Fukuyama shouted from the rooftops that history had ended, that capitalism and democracy were the final answers to all our woes, or all economic and political woes. But that euphoria proved to be short-lived, as we have seen. The Great Recession of 2008 has finally struck a big blow to that particular idea. As you can find, Europe is in crisis, America is yet to solidly recover from the crisis. Many of the emerging economies are on the back foot. India is still far, far away from moving on to a double-digit growth trajectory. So implementing reforms has become difficult. And now the state is being proclaimed as a savior of the markets. Now the publication, in addition to that, the publication of Thomas Piketty's book, Capital in the 21st Century, and the various Occupy movements across countries around the globe have brought to central stage the issues of inequality, poverty, and growth. So in this backdrop, Professor Ghuman's attempt to set the dynamics of growth, poverty, and inequality acquires a special significance. Broadly speaking, he addresses two of the most challenging issues of political economy, the economic growth and poverty linkage, and the growth inequality linkage. These issues are so contentious that they have kept the two doyens of Indian economics, Professor Amartya Sen and Professor Jagdish Bhagwati, sparring with each other for over four decades now. So, Professor Ghuman, you had a very tough task at hand, I understand that. What he says, let me summarize for you the contents of his paper. Okay. Okay, sir. He says that growth matters, but agriculture, if you have agricultural growth, that will help reduce poverty. Since I'm in broad agreement with many of the things that he said, I still have a few questions. First, you say that inequality has gone up in the previous two or three decades, but we must realize that inequality has gone up in an environment of rising income. That is the first thing. So we must, in an environment of rising income. Secondly, you ask for a multi-pronged development approach, or a more human development-centered approach, which I find it very difficult to understand. Because you still were making a lot of, you're spending a lot of, the social spending in India is already very high. The market is active, the state is active in various areas. So we already have a human-centered approach. So are you saying that the growth or the economic reforms, they don't have a human face? So I was wondering that. Third, in the final section of the paper, you are very critical of Reaganomics, Thatcherism, you attack, you cite papers, they attack IMF, the World Bank, and the neoliberal policies. But we needed to realize, that it was the same set of policies that gave rise to high growth, generated resources, that has made all these big, huge programs possible. So somewhere you have to give credit to those. On inequality, your concern for inequality is well taken. Well, the fact that inequality is rising is something acceptable. But what causes that inequality? What are the sources of that inequality? That is something we need to know. Economists may prove to quibble about the relative importance of the various factors leading to inequality, but there are two things that we need to take note of. First is, in the past 30 years, skill-biased technological change has taken place. Globalization and economies are much more integrated now, and among the social factors, the loosening of the power of the union. So I hope you will get to hear from you on all these issues, and also kindly suggest policy suggestions. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much indeed. The final discussion now will be by Abhimanyu.
Before I start my presentation, I would like to clarify that I, as an Indian who has lived in India pretty much all his life, I agree that India remains an overwhelmingly poor country. But in the presentation today, I would like to focus on whether or not poverty has declined. This seemed to be one of the questions that was posed in Professor Das's paper, and that's what I'm focusing on. I agree that India remains a very, very poor country, but what has been the trend in poverty is what I'm discussing. There are three central assertions that are presented in Professor Das's paper. The first one is that although headcount ratios, as given by Tendulkar methodology, as given by the Rangarajan methodology, show that poverty rate has been steadily declining. However, there also seems to be a decline in calorie intake over the reform period. That's number one. Secondly, Professor Das's paper claims that land distribution and incidence of tenancy cultivation are important institutional factors that determine poverty rates. And the third is that although the Indian economy seems to be undergoing a structural change, it has not achieved structural transformation. And these two are very different things. These are the three aspects that I'd like to focus on. In the interest of time, I'm only going to take on the last point from this slide, which is that both Tendulkar and Rangarajan estimates demonstrate that poverty since 1993 has been declining at a fairly steady rate of 0.8 percentage points a year. While that might seem like not very much, if you accumulate that over the last two decades, it comes to about 16 to 20% percentage points decline, which is massive. And you cannot detract from the fact that the per capita growth that has been happening in India since 1991 would have been a major factor in determining this decline in the headcount ratio. Now, coming to Professor Das's contention, there has been a decline in calorie intake over the reform period. Whatever is in italics here is taken directly from the paper. There has been a decline in calorie intake over the reform period, partly due to the decline in cereal consumption, which is the major source of calorie for the Indians. I think it is suggested that this stands against the evidence of poverty reduction proposed by the headcount ratios that I presented in the last slide. If we look at the data, this data is taken from Professor Das's paper. If we compare the calorie intakes in 1993 and 2011, the 15 states for which data has been presented, out of those 10 states show an increase in the calorie consumption, not a decline. Out of the 5 states that demonstrated decline in calorie consumption, 3 of them have a calorie consumption decline of less than 50 calories. It's only 2 states, Rajasthan and Uttar Pradesh, where calorie consumption has declined by more than 100. So the data does not seem to support the assertion that calorie consumption has been declining. I've already covered this. So, however, I was searching for other papers that might boost Professor Das's claim or try to controvert it. So there seems to be a very thriving research scene in something called the calorie consumption puzzle. Which is that, and this research seems to back the claim that declining calorie consumption in rural India has been happening, even as real expenditures and incomes have increased. There was a paper by Professors Chandrasekhar and Ghosh in 2003. They claim that between 1983 and 2009, the average inflation-adjusted monthly expenditure of households increased by 28%, but during the same period, calorie intake declined by 16%. However, this is limited to rural India. They find that if we look across Indian states with rural and urban indicators combined, they find a robust, positive relationship between the expenditure and average calorie intake. Okay. What are the possible explanations for this trend? Incomes are increasing, but calorie consumption is not increasing in rural India. There was a paper by Professors Deaton and Drells, which says that declining calories need to not as many calories are needed as they were before because of reduced physical intensity of work. A second explanation is increase in the relative price of food, dietary diversification leading to consumption of more expensive calories. And there are several other papers that seem to say that there are very good reasons to assume that even with increasing incomes, calorie consumption can decline, which does not say very much about what is happening to the poverty rates. Now, moving to the second assertion in the paper, per capita calorie intake is found to be negatively related to land concentration and the incidence of tenancy cultivation. I've lived in Bihar for the last 2.5-3 years, and this is a discussion that keeps cropping up. What Bihar needs is land reforms. What the rest of India needs is land reforms. And this particular claim seems to back that line of thinking. Land concentration is negatively related to calorie intake, and this only seems to further cement the fact that land reforms are needed in India. The third assertion, and I'm slightly confused here, I would like Professor Das to please explain this further. Indian economy has undergone structural changes since the 1980s, but structural transformation is yet to happen, is something that's said in the paper. While I tend to broadly agree with this statement, I am left thinking what exactly is the difference between structural growth and structural transformation. Because if you look at their definitions, they seem particularly close together. They seem very, very close together. Now, the data also shows that services sector has gained at the expense of agriculture in the share of GDP, while industry has broadly maintained its share around 25%. So if you go by the conventional definition of structural transformation, Indian economy has been transforming. So I would like to understand what the difference between structural change and structural transformation is. Coming to the last 2 slides, what can be the further research in terms of poverty estimates and whether growth has an effect on poverty reduction? Data shows that until 1977, rural and urban poverty proportions fluctuated with no downward trend, remaining at around 51% till 1977. Now, since 19... Can you guys hear me at the back?
Yeah.
This paper suggests that India needs more formal sector employment to ensure poverty reduction. I don't think anybody can disagree with that statement. However, we also need to note the fact that in today's workforce, it's only 8% of the workforce that's in the formal sector. So should we be advocating that India should increase its formal sector employment, or should we be rethinking what formal sector employment means? There are several authors who suggest that the formal sector today might be too rigidly formal, with too much job security for too few, So how should we think about reforming this without also compromising on labor rights? Also, I think a major theme at the time of independence, as Professor Das has pointed out, was a discussion between what kind of growth model should India follow. And Mahalanobis model won hands down then. But there were two other lesser known stalwarts, Professor.
Thanks very much. I'm sorry to have had to cut you short, but that really was no option. Okay, you might want to respond to the, yes, 2 minutes each, please. This is going to be particularly difficult because some critical inputs have been offered to me. But to do the best that you can and resolve your differences at lunchtime.
Thank you, Manish, for going through the whole paper and raising very significant questions. True inequality has gone up, but income has gone up, which means the benefit of increasing income has not gone to the larger population. As regards multi-pronged approach, I don't mean that growth is not with human face, but one can easily say that from the reforms onward, growth has lost somewhere human face. As regards criticism of economics and Thatcherism, I'm a stark critic of Thatcherism. Economics in 70s, Thatcherism in 80s, and Washington consensus in towards the end of 80s, and the structural program which comes from IMF and World Bank imposed on the third world countries. I'm a strong critic of that, and that has done more harm than good to the larger interests of the countries. And the last, regarding sources of income, of course, ownership of means of production and the capabilities of the interpersonal capabilities, both in terms of skill and education, and of course, informal sectors, very, very high proportion, now 93%, without any security cover. That explains your poverty as well as inequality. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
First of all, I must thank Abhimanyu for serious and sincere comments for the paper. I agree many points you have raised, but due to time constraint, I am focusing on particular 2 points, partly structural change and structural transformation, as well as the rise in informal sector like this. Structural change is simply the change of the economy through one sector to another sector, and it is easily captured by showing the percentage change in percentage share from agriculture to services, industry, etc. Structural transformation is different. Structural transformation means it is observed if we look at the employment pattern. So although structural change appears, structural transformation appears, does not appear in that sense. Even today, over 90% of the workforce lies attached to the informal sector as before. So in that sense, and we have failed through either through the planning or through the market mechanism to shift the informal economy to the formal economy. But what we have experienced the opposite, informalization increased in a significant way, particularly during the post-reform period. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Before I throw this discussion open to the floor, I'd just like to take 1 minute to address a couple of comments. This is simply to say, I mean, both papers have obviously been on extremely important themes. Professor Woman, much of the work that you have done has depended upon the actual measurement of the phenomena of poverty and inequality, and implicitly of inclusion. inclusive growth. Now, on all three of these phenomena, I think the protocols of measurement that we have are so deeply suspect as to call severely into question both the magnitudes and the trends of these phenomena that we measure. So I think your paper would greatly benefit from a review of some of these issues, and by reference to other literature which casts doubt, especially in the matter of inequality, but also the pernicious influence of the World Bank Dollar Day poverty line tradition of measuring poverty. So measurement protocols, in other words, I would say, would constitute an important subject for further inquiry and criticism on your part. In your case, Professor Das, I think there is more than one paper in your paper. I mean, the problem is there are two or three themes, all of them unexceptionable, but each of which might have benefited from separate treatment rather than being sort of put into one paper. What would also, I think, help your paper very considerably is by drawing on both existing and previous literature. There are some important components of this literature that I think don't find their way in your reference list. And they also address the question which Abhimanyu raised, not least with respect to the calorie puzzle or the calorie drift paradox. There have been recent efforts in this direction, which I think, and also older efforts, which have been very largely neglected in the literature, but more recent efforts as well, which we can talk about.
Just a minute, sir. Yeah. Thank you very much, but I have included the review in my full paper, but because of time, but I will relook as you said. Thank you.
Thank you. You see, we started 12 minutes late, and we have got 10 minutes to 1 o'clock, so I'm happy to be guided on whether we should have a question and answer session, and if so, at best, I think we can have 3 questions. So 3 questions in all. And the 3 who will ask the questions are the ones whom I'll see through the accidental order of precedence that is available to me. 1, 2, and 3. That's it. So please. Irke paas de dijiye. Sab.
Professor Das, for Professor Das, I think the urban also impacts on rural poverty trend. So, considering the rural and urban poverty dynamics separately may not be always useful. So, you might consider that. Secondly, the per capita state level GDP you have used for growth. But it might be useful to look at the per capita NSS survey expenditure as a indicator of growth and see whether your conclusion is validated. And third is, Professor Guman, is that you mentioned because you have been assembling data and all that at your disposal, in 2015 actually World Bank recognized formally Bangladesh being as the in the lower middle income group. One. And secondly,
what's the first comment? First comment? He didn't hear what you said.
Oh, in 2015 World Bank recognized Bangladesh as being in the lower middle income group. Bangladesh government officially also declared itself. There is a bit of a data issue there that I can discuss with you separately, because that is based on a revised GDP series based on 2005-06 base and not the series you have shown. Thank you.
Hello. My question is, you have highlighted the economic and human development indicators across the different countries over time. Regarding the policy paradigms and specific policies and their success and failure, so can you throw, what lessons can we learn across the different countries? the first presentation here, you said.
Good afternoon, sir. My question is for Mr. Ranjit. Sir, your data depicts that rate of economic growth in India and South Asia is impressive. But still, why in India and South Asia, the poorest are not catching up with richest fast enough?
Thank you, Chair. As regards policy suggestions, they are not new, but given the kind of asset distribution, that's land, and given the distribution of income and given the very high proportion of labor in the informal sector with not good working conditions and at low wages, and most of the population is still having a very low average years of schooling and low level of skill. So policy implication or suggestion can be that first empower the population, particularly in the school age and the youth population, with the good quality education, good quality skill, and increase their employability. And that would come not from the private sector alone. Public sector will have to play a major role. The second is that since agriculture is pushing out workforce out of agriculture, and employment elasticity in agriculture is shrinking, as well as the total mandates in agriculture are shrinking, you will have to find work for them and making them employable in other sectors, particularly in the rural non-farm sector. The rural non-farm sector's growth and generation of employment is very, very important. So that again needs policy intervention. My conviction is that you cannot leave all these things to the market. And even in 50s, 60s, the pro-market liberal economists, they never pleaded for free play of market forces. As regards the second question, can you repeat? I couldn't get what you said. Can you?
Sir, sir, I've said that, as your data depicts that rate of economic growth in India and South Asia is quite impressive. But still, why in India and South Asia the poorest are not catching up with the richest fast enough? What was the reason behind it?
No. I think your question carries the answer. That rate of growth has picked up, inequality has not gone down, whereas poverty certainly has gone down, particularly in India as well as in two other countries, leaving aside Bangladesh. So rate of growth of GDP is a necessary condition for focusing on poverty alleviation or even on inequality, but not a sufficient condition. So for that, to make it sufficient condition, we'll have to bring in other factors such as policy intervention. In particularly, MNREGA is one, right to education is another, which the measures have been taken during the last couple of years. But unfortunately, now the budgetary allocation to education and health and others again is not being focused in that direction. And the last, even if skill development program, which is widely propagated in India, the medium of skill development is not the already established mechanism, which is ITIs and polytechnics. Of the firm opinion that we should strengthen our ITIs and polytechnics rather than giving it to freehand private sector alone and violating the funds which are earmarked for that skill development. Thank you.
Thank you so much for valuable comments. I am totally agree with Professor Subramaniam. This paper is actually a collection of papers. Actually, this is a major area of interest I would go through recently. So it should be splitted into a separate parts. And Dr. Sen, you are absolutely right. And I have a plan to do the similar work by taking unit level information from NSSO as a growth parameter, not to per capita GDP, but to take the monthly per capita consumption expenditure to make the analysis more meaningful by using the unit level information of several towns. Thank you.
Very well done. It's a stroke of one, so I think we'll close now with very many thanks to the speakers and the discussants and the audience. Oh, yes.